thanks to the organizers for inviting me to this beautiful event. As Nicola, I didn't have the pleasure to meet the Georgie, so that's one thing that I always regret. At least I was lucky enough to have Luigi's advisor, so in some sense I could get something of the Georgie through him. Another person inspired me a lot has also been Luis Caffarelli, who couldn't come today. Also Luis has been influenced a lot in his mathematics by the ideas of the Georgie. It has been during my years in Austin that I learned a lot about free boundary problems. And what I will present today is exactly something on this topic. So I found it was pertinent with the spirit of the conference. So I will try to be as, let's say, elementary as possible. So I will start first with some classical results and give an overview of, let's say, old results. So let me start with the classical obstacle problem. So the classical obstacle problem is the following. You have a function phi defined in a domain omega that represents your obstacle. You have a boundary datum f that is above your obstacle. And in fact, what you do is that you minimize the energy and the Dirich energy among all functions that are above the obstacle and takes boundary data f. So this is the variational problem. Minimize the gradient u square with that conditions. So this is a picture. You have your obstacle below. And you see there is here the obstacle. You have f, that's your boundary data. And you minimize the Dirich energy, you will find some function like this. That's your u. And so the kind of things you want to understand in this kind of problems are the regularity of u, so your solution, and the regularity of the free boundary, where the free boundary is essentially the region that you obtain, is the contact region, is the region where u coincides with the obstacle. So to understand this, let me discuss very briefly the property of solutions. So when you have a variational problem, what you do is that you compute the Lagrange equations. So here, what you cannot take any kind of variation because you have this constraint, u greater or equal than phi, that you have to preserve. So if you use a minimizer, you notice that u plus epsilon v is admissible provided epsilon is positive and v is non-negative. In this way, this will still be above the obstacle. And then by minimality, the energy of u plus epsilon v is larger than the energy of u. Then I simply divide by epsilon, so this quantity is non-negative, and then I take the limit as epsilon tends to zero, and this is what I get. So this expression must be non-negative for every test function v, and this tells me that the Laplacian has a sign. In other words, u is superharmonic. Okay. And also, you notice that in the region where u doesn't touch the obstacle, you can actually prove that the Laplacian must be zero. The reason being that when you don't touch the obstacle, you don't have any extra constraint, so it's like for the classical Dirichlet energy, minimizers of the Dirichlet energy are harmonic functions. So here you get an extra condition. So from these two conditions, you want to understand regularity. Okay, so as I say, the main two questions are the regularity of u and the regularity of the free boundary. And let's start with the regularity of u. So by superharmonicity, you have the mean value theorem that tells you that the value of u is bigger than the average of u over any ball. In fact, this quantity, this average as a function of the radius is decreasing. This is the mean value inequality for superharmonic functions. So this is a picture. And so essentially, what do you have as information? So let's say that x0 is a free boundary point. So on the one end, the mean value inequality tells you that the value of u at this point controls the value of u in average in a neighborhood. So this is the first information for every radius. So you have a bound from above from this. Now, from the obstacle, you have a pointwise bound from below. U cannot go below the obstacle. And also, in the region where u and phi don't coincide, u is harmonic. So you have an information in average, but you have harmonicity. And so if you have an harmonic function and you have information in average, you can make informations, you can make your information pointwise. So you have a bound from above by this information, you have a bound from below because of the obstacle, you play with that, and you end up with a kind of result like this. So this was already proved in a much more general situation for much more general equations by Brezis and Kinderle, that essentially, okay, maybe with C11, this is due to Luis. The result 5 should be smoother in the general framework. But so let's say the clear point is that, let's say if the obstacle is smooth, the solution is C11. That's really the key point. The optimal regularity for solutions to these problems is C11. And what's also important is that you cannot go above that. So C2 is false. And the reason why solutions are not C2 is simply explained by this picture. So take your obstacle phi, and think of phi as being like a nice concave function. Then the Laplacian of phi will be strictly negative. Now, on the contact region, the Laplacian of u and the Laplacian of phi will coincide. So the Laplacian of u is also strictly negative. On the other end, outside the contact region, the Laplacian of u is 0. And so you see that the Laplacian has a jump. So the Laplacian is not continuous, which means that u cannot be C2. So C11 is optimal. OK, so by now we know that by C11 regularity, essentially if I have a, if I take a free boundary point, so this is a, here I wrote as the free boundary point is 0. So if you have this function, u is C11, phi C11, they coincide, let's say, at a free boundary point, and one is above the other, they cannot detach faster than r square. Okay, maybe this is a constant there. But the growth is r square. This is just by C11 regularity. On the other hand, the key fact in this problem is that if you assume that your Laplacian of phi is strictly negative, then actually you can prove that you can also find a lower bound on this quantity of the same kind. So not only the sup is bounded by r squared from above, but it's also bounded by r squared from below, up to constants. And so essentially you prove that your function behaves like r squared. And so this is the non-degeneracy property. And this is crucial because then you can try to use the following strategy for the free boundary, which is blow up. So what is blow up? You take your function, you subtract the obstacle, and you rescale like r squared. And you consider this function VR. So this function, because of this property, this function is of size 1 in B1. So it's in every ball, let's say, in every ball of radius of fixed radius, your function is bounded from above and below. Let's say the sup of this function is bounded from above and below. And then you take a limit. And then you say, OK, can I classify these limits? So the blow-up strategy is to try to understand what happens when you rescale your solution. And this is what Luis did. So this is a combination of some of his results in the 77 papers, and then there have been a second approach in 98 papers, again by Luis. So what he proves is that every blow-up is convex, first. So this was already in the 77 paper. And actually, he could classify blow-ups and prove that you have only two options. So either the blow-up is a half space solution, so is you take x1 positive part square, so it's 0 on one side of the half space, and then it goes like x1 square on the other side, okay, flat and like this. Or it's a polynomial, so sum of ci xi square, where all the coefficients are non-negative, because this function must be convex, and this, the sum must be strictly positive. So these are the only two options. So what is the free boundary for this guy? For this guy, so the set, the contact region, so here you have to think that I subtracted the obstacle, so let me go back. You see, here I was interested in u equal to phi. So u equal to phi means u minus phi equals 0, and so here now I'm interested in v bar equals 0. So this is my new, the contact region. So v bar equals 0, you see that is either a half space, in the first case, or is a lower dimensional set. So the contact region is smaller. And these are so-called non-singular points in one case and singular points in the other case. And the theorem that Luis proved is that the set of non-singular points is nice, is a C1 alpha hypersurface, while the set of singular points is contained in C1 hypersurfaces. Okay? Actually, for the non-singular points, these are much nicer. If you can prove by a result of Kinderler and Nirenberg that if the obstacle is smooth, the solution is smooth there, and the free boundary is smooth. So you can go to C infinity here if you have smoother obstacles. So this is essentially the situation. So basically, you have your free boundary, and you have a nice stratification depending on the singular and non-singular points, and that's essentially it. Okay, now I want to move to something new, and this is about fractional obstacle problem. So for that, I want to very, very briefly motivate that with some math finance. So, and why I need to introduce this is not because you wouldn't believe if I wrote you a PDE. I mean, I could tell you this PDE comes from math finance. I think everyone would believe that. But there is one extra condition which will be crucial in my proof, and that you don't see it unless you know the model. So for people who know a bit of math finance, in math finance, usually the position X represents the prices of your assets. Your solution V is the price of an option. So an option is some right that you have to buy some stock at some given time. And the given time is this capital T, which is called expiration time, before a given time, sorry. This is in American market. And the kind of situation that you have is this. So you have that your price is always greater or equal than your payoff, so what you get at the expiration time. Your price is equal to the payoff at the expiration time. So this is the reason why this is true is that if this price will go below, you will just exercise your option before the expiration time. So you can never go below. It's not interesting. And whenever you are above the payoff, there is a stochastic process that determines, governs the evolution. So you have an equation here. So now you can think, now you can forget the model, but I mean what they come from. So essentially you have a function V which is greater than a psi. Whenever it's strictly greater than psi, it solves an equation. And then at some time capital T is equal to psi. What is the operator L? If you look in the models, usually this looks something like a backward parabolic. But in a strange form, there are always these, the prices usually are positive, xi, so these are the prices of the axis, so xi lives in the positive quadrant. And you have this operator of first order, zero order term, first order term, second order term, and some non-local term. And if you perform a change of variable, xi into log, then you find something much more familiar, which is just a parabolic equation, backward in time, with zero term, first order term, second order term, and then this non-local operator. Now, let's look at this equation. There are two models. Either you assume, let's say that if you put yourself in the simple situation where there is no non-local term, so you remove k, you assume this is zero, and your coefficients are smooth, coefficient Q are smooth and uniformly elliptic, so you are in the parabolic setting, then the solution here is going to be C11 in space and C1 in time. So you see, this is the regularity that we saw in the standard obstacle problem before. So this is just the parabolic version of the previous problem. You have time. Think that the operator is the Laplacian. So essentially now, instead of having the Laplacian, I have the heat equation. I have an extra variable, and that's the regularity. On the other hand, since the 70s, people started to use more and more in stochastic processes. So this equation corresponds like to a Brownian motion in the evolution of the stock market. But using this, having something non-local corresponds to the fact that you have jump processes. So the price of stocks could jump. And this is something that we see a lot, especially right now in the stock market, so this jump of prices. And so that's why people started to get more and more interested on having non-local operators. So the question I want to address is what happens if I assume that my dynamics is governed by non-local operator? So I'm gonna assume that Q is zero, I remove the Brownian motion, but I only have jump processes. So in this case, I need to gain regularity from K, and a very natural hypothesis is that my operator at first order looks like a fractional Laplacian, maybe with some slower order. And in a sense, now I will forget every lower order term and just restrict to this guy. So I do another change of variable. So I don't like backward parabolic. You see here the, I have, here is like Vt plus Laplacian. I like Vt minus Laplacian, like the heat equation. So I do just change of variable. So capital tau is capital T minus little t. In this way, little t becomes the standard time. It's not negative. I set ut to be v of tau x, and then this becomes my model. So what do I have? U greater or equal than the obstacle. Whenever it's above the obstacle, it solves the fractional heat equation. When it's equal to the obstacle, I have an inequality. And this corresponds, this is the analog in Caffarelli of superharmonicity. You remember, in this obstacle problem, you have Laplacian less or equal than zero, and is equal to zero when it's detached. Here is the same. When I'm detached, I have an equation, but when I touch, I have an inequality. That's still there. I didn't explain before, but it's there. But the crucial thing that comes from the model is the fact that the obstacle coincides with the initial datum. And this is something I wouldn't know to justify if I didn't start from the model. So the obstacle is equal to the initial condition. And this is crucial, and we will see why. So let me first explain to you what is the fractional Laplacian. So the fractional Laplacian can be defined in many ways. The standard definition is by Fourier transform. So the way, same way the Laplacian is the Fourier multipliers of Xi squared, the fractional Laplacian is the Fourier Fourier multiplier as Xi to the 2s. So you do the Fourier transform of V, you multiply by minus Xi to the 2s, and you do the Fourier transform backward. Maybe up to sign. Yeah, I never know about the sign. And here, yeah, I think there is a minus. You can write it. So if you compute the Fourier transform of Xi to the 2s, in fact, the Fourier transform of this is 1 over y to the n plus 2s. So this is the Fourier transform of this. And so you have an expression without Fourier transform, which is just the principal value of v of x plus y minus v of x over y to the n plus 2s. So you have an integral of this form with that weight below. And there is a dimensional constant. But I will not use this. There is another definition that was very well known for s equal 1 half, less well known for s different from 1 half. So the fractional Laplacian can be defined as a Dirichlet to Neumann operator, and that's the way you do it. So take your function v in Rn. So I said you can compute the Fourier transform or whatever, but do this. Add one extra variable, y, and extend your function little v to a function capital V in this extra variable, solving a Dirichlet problem. So you find V, which is the harmonic extension, so you see capital V is harmonic here, and has Dirichlet value on the half, on this boundary of the half space equal to little v. So you just solve a Dirichlet problem for the Laplacian. Then up to a constant, I will forget constants, the 1 half Laplacian of V at this point is nothing else than the y derivative of V, capital V at this point. So it's just the Neumann condition, it's the normal derivative. So the normal derivative of capital V gives me exactly the fractional Laplacian of little v. So it's a Dirichlet to Neumann because you take V, you solve the Dirichlet problem, you compute the Neumann condition, and this gives you the fractional Laplacian. This is with 1 half, and this is a classical fact. Actually, it was also classical since more than 30 years, then you could do this for every fractional operator, for every power of the Laplacian. But in a sense, this was kind of unknown in the PDE community. People never realized that. Until in 2007, Caffarelli and Silvestre kind of reproved that independently and gave a very simple proof of the following fact, that if you want to recover the fractional Laplacian with any exponent s, what you do is that you have to solve a new equation now. So it's a Dirichlet problem, but it's not the Laplacian anymore. You have a weight here inside, y to the a, A is related to S through this formula. In particular, A is 0 when S is 1 half. So for S 1 half, you get the Laplacian. And then you compute a Neumann operator in this way. You compute y to the vy, and then you take the limit as y tends to 0. OK, there is a formula. Just if you don't remember, it doesn't matter. You can just try to remember at least the previous one for 1 half with the Laplacian. So the point is that these fractional Laplacians can be just treated by adding one extra variable and then working with local operators. OK, and this is useful. So let me mention now, let me try to explain to you what happens to for the fractional Laplacian, the regularity of solutions. OK, so what do we have? So I removed time, so let me go back to my problem. The problem was this. OK, let me remove the initial condition because otherwise there is nothing. Just look at the first three conditions and remove time. So let's take the stationary solution that you can think of it as the time as t goes to infinity of the parabolic equation. So then you have these three conditions. You remove time. So you have u greater than psi. Laplacian of S of u is 0 when you're above the obstacle. And Laplacian S of u is always less or equal than 0. And this is what I drew. What I drew here. Okay. Then in 2008, Caffarelli, Silvestri, and Salsa proved the optimal regularity here, that u is C1s. So you see, for s equal 1, you recover the C11 by numerology. I mean, their proof is not very uniform, as s converges to 1, but let's say the numerology is correct. And this was already known for s equal 1 half. There was a proof in 2004 in every dimension by Athanasopoulos Caffarelli. And in fact, it was already known in, since many years ago in the two-dimensional case for s equal 1 half. So what they really prove, in fact, is that the Laplacian S of u is C01 minus s. And I wanted to write this because that's really what you prove in the parabolic case. Then by leap, so the fractional Laplacian works like the Laplacian. So Laplacian u equal f, f is C0 alpha, u is C2 alpha. Laplacian makes you gain two derivatives, OK? The fractional Laplacian makes you gain 2s derivatives. So if you know that the fractional Laplacian of u is C0, 1 minus s, then u has 2s derivatives more than this one. So 1 minus s plus 2s is 1 plus s, which is this, 1 plus s. So these two statements are completely equivalent by elliptic regularity. So it's enough to prove this. Okay, so this is what they proved. Okay, and this is optimal. So there are examples, and I will come back to this. So you cannot prove anything better than this. Now let me make a comment, and this will be useful because we want to understand what we can prove in the parabolic case by observing that, by discussing another problem that was already very classical, the Signorini problem. So what is the Signorini problem? It's simply the classical obstacle problem that we studied before, minimizing Dirichlet energy. The difference now is that, you see, let's say my ambient space is Rn plus 1, but my obstacle lives in Rn. So my obstacle has one dimension less than the ambient space. And so I only have the obstacle condition in Rn. So I ask that I minimize Dirichlet energy with the condition that u is above the obstacle, but only in this lower dimensional set. You compute the Euler-Lagrange equations. You have that the Laplacian is 0, well, outside the obstacle. And because it's 0, So in fact, what you get, okay, is Laplacian 0 when u is greater than psi, sorry. And because the function is harmonic when they don't touch, in particular, the function is smooth across here. In this region where they don't touch, the function is smooth. And so if it is smooth, and the function is also by symmetry, the function is going to be even in y. If it's smooth and even, uy is going to be 0 there by symmetry. So simply by smoothness, ui at this point must be 0. You have an even function, it must have zero derivative. And so you have this that translates into that, that u y is zero when u is greater than psi. But once you remember that u y is Laplacian 1/2, what I'm doing here is nothing else than the obstacle problem for Laplacian 1/2, for the restriction of u to this hyperplane. So the obstacle problem for Laplacian 1/2 in Rn is equivalent to the Signorini problem in Rn plus 1. They're exactly the same problem. And this is just by this relation between Uy and Laplacian 1/2 u. Okay, so why I wanted to repeat in some sense this, because this will give me a kind of a way to guess the optimal, let's say the kind of regularity I can prove for my parabolic setting. So let's go to the parabolic case. What regularity can I hope to prove? I will start to build examples. So the problem, I will look at the problem for s equal 1/2, that's the easiest to find examples. Dimension 1, n equal 1, and then I have an extra variable y. And let's put obstacle equal 0. And the, okay? And I just try to find solutions. I forget the initial condition, because I want to the idea is that I want to classify blow-ups of possible blow-ups of my solutions. So I just try to look for solution to my equations. So I look at my problem, instead of looking at the fractional Laplace, I look at my problem as a Signorini problem, but a Signorini type problem, where, in the sense that I use the extension, and you see that, so maybe let me go back to my equation, just repeat it as you want. Let's look what is my system. This is my system. S equals is 1/2. So ut equal Laplacian s of u. Laplacian 1/2 of u. But the Laplacian 1/2 is uy when I use the extension. So I can write this in this way. Okay, this. This is ut equal Laplacian 1/2. But in this way, it's kind of easy, right? So I have an harmonic function in a half space. It must be non-negative here. And whenever it's positive, at this point, ut is equal to uy. So there is a kind of transport equation. You see, it's a first order PD of transport type, ut uy. So the observation is that ut equal uy is a hyperbolic scaling. So I may hope to find solutions as traveling waves. So I can look for solution of the form u of txy equal w of at plus xy. This is what you try to do in hyperbolic problems. Just y is just a parameter, and you relate t and x in a linear way. So you plug in u of this form, and you find that an elliptic equation for w. So wy equal awx when w is positive, and w is harmonic in the half space. Okay, so it's just an elliptic problem in the half space in R2. Okay, how do you find solution to this? There is a very cheap trick. Anytime you want to find an harmonic function, remember that harmonic functions are can be found as real and imaginary parts of holomorphic functions. And so what you do is that you just take z equal x plus y, x plus iy. This is a standard complex variable. You take z to a power beta, and then real and imaginary part of it are harmonic for free. So then it's just, you just plug in a function of this form. This is satisfied for free. The problem is to satisfy this just boundary condition. You check, and you find this relation, that w equal minus the imaginary part of z 1 plus gamma solves the equation you are looking for, and there is a relation between a and gamma, which is given by this curve, 1 over tangent of gamma over pi. Okay, fair enough. But what is the outcome of this? I found a solution to my problem, okay? For every gamma, I can find a solution. So for every gamma, there is a for which I have a solution. This means that for every gamma, I can find a solution which is only C1 gamma, not better, to my problem. Okay? So, and gamma can be as small as I want. So, if you remember in the stationary problem, the optimal regularity was C1 1 half, S equal 1 half. So, C1 1 half was the optimal regularity. Here, for every gamma between 0 and 1, I can find a solution that has that regularity. And this is a bad sign, because in the classical proof of obstacle problems, what you prove usually is the following. First, you prove that your solution maybe is Lipschitz, then that is C1 alpha for some small alpha, and then you push the alpha all the way to the optimal one. But if I can find solution with gamma as small as I want, I will never be able to prove that my solutions are C1 alpha for some alpha, because I have counterexamples. Okay, so the parabolic problem, you see, has a conceptual difficulty with respect to the elliptic problem. There are very bad solutions. But we are lucky, because in the finance problem, the solution at time zero is equal to the obstacle. And it's because it must be greater or equal to the obstacle by maximum principal argument, you can prove that ut is always non-negative. So there is an extra information coming from the fact that you start from the obstacle itself. So what happens is at time zero, you are equal to the obstacle, and then as time evolves, you start to detach. And so you can only go up. This means that if I go back to my problem, to my solutions here, the only admissible solutions here are the one which have non-negative time derivative. The other one, I don't care. They don't come from the math finance problem. And so the only admissible ones are A less or equal than zero, which means gamma greater or equal than one half. So this is a case where it's important to look from which model my equation is coming from. If you just look at the equation purely by PD terms, you would have forgotten the initial condition, and then you would have proven no theorem, because there is no theorem, no regularity theorem you can really prove. There are counterexamples. But because... Sorry?
What was A?
A was the speed of the traveling wave. The A parameter A. So the fact that my solution has time, positive time derivative corresponds to A less or equal than zero, that corresponds to gamma greater or equal than one half. So it was a bit, okay? I was trying to look for traveling waves, and I can rule out all the ones which have negative time derivative. But this is because of the model. So this is a case where it's crucial to understand the model. Okay, so this is very good. Then maybe we have a hope to prove out something because of this extra information, ut non-negative. This must play a crucial role. And in fact, that's what we did with Luis 3 years ago. If psi is nice, there are some conditions, let's say a nice obstacle that gets nicely at infinity, then look at this way. So forget the second line for a second. So the ut and Laplacian S are C1 minus S in space and C1 minus S over 2S minus in time. Minus means for every epsilon positive, this function are C1 minus S over 2S minus epsilon. So we cannot get the full exponent, but we lose an epsilon. So if you remove time, if you are in the stationary case, this is Laplacian S is C1 minus S, which is exactly the result of Caffarelli, Silvestre, and Salza. So it's the optimal regularity in space. Now, and below 1/3, this regularity becomes a log Lipschitz regularity. So the remark is that when S is 1 half, for instance, you get 1 half in space, 1 half minus in time. That's almost optimal by the traveling wave solutions. And at 1/3, something happens. And the reason is that at 1/3, this exponent becomes 1. So the reason why this is 1 minus S and this is 1 minus S over 2S is just by scaling. So if you use a solution and you scale variable in this way, this is still a solution. And so this naturally gives a relation between the regularity in space and the regularity in time with an extra power 2S. But then there is something that happens when S reaches 1, when this exponent reaches 1. And so that's for S equal 1/3. Whatever. It's not essential. So this is the regularity of solutions. And that's where I stop for about this problem, the elliptic problem. Now let's move to the free boundary. That's really the new part that I want to discuss today. Okay, so this was all stuff. Let me step back. Elliptic problem first. What is known? In the stationary case, you have many stationary solutions. So if you take n equal 1, psi equal 0, so the same as in my picture here, you look, but you look at this problem without time derivative, ut equals 0. Okay, this is the stationary solution. These are stationary solutions for this. You can try to look for them. Actually, you can classify them. And then your solutions are these. All the stationary solution global are, you have all these minus imaginary part of two z to the 2k minus 1 half, where k is 1, 2, 3, etc. But then you also have polynomials. For instance, x squared minus y squared is also a solution. And you have higher order polynomials. So what is the lowest homogeneity? K equal 1 corresponds to 2 minus 1 half, 3 halves. So the x to the 3 half is the first solution you find with the least growth. And that's the optimal regularity, C1 1 half. So it has a 3 half growth. Then you have an x squared growth here. So you have a growth 2. Then here you have, next one is 7 over 2. And you go on, 11 over 2. Then you have, 3 over 2, 2, 7 over 2, and so on. So there are a lot of solutions. And in particular, if you remember the classical obstacle problem, the starting point of Caffarelli in the classical obstacle problem is false, because there was non-degeneracy. At the beginning, we did the classical obstacle problem, and a crucial fact there was this, that the optimal regularity is 2, C1, 1 half, but you have non-degeneracy. So what is true from above is true from below. So you always grow at least like a square. Here is false, because the optimal regularity is 3 over 2, but you have solutions that can grow extremely slow at the origin. And so what Caffarelli San Silvestre proved is the following. So take a point on the free boundary and assume that u minus psi divided by r square in a ball of reduced r goes to infinity. So this basically rules out this solution and also all other solutions except for k equal 1, which is the first one, the dominant one. So this, here I'm classifying this only in dimension 2, but this result is true in every dimension. Okay? So once you rule out, in some sense, these degenerate solutions, and you are in this situation, then you can prove so that if your homogeneity is below 1, is below 2, then actually your homogeneity is exactly 1 plus s. Here I'm back to the fractional Laplacian s. And u minus psi over r 1 plus s blow up to a half space solution. X1 positive part to the 1 plus s. So this is like for Caffarelli when it had 2. So this is like these are the non-degenerate points, as in Caffarelli. And at these points, the free boundary is C1 alpha. Actually, if the obstacle is smooth, the free boundary is infinity. Okay? So this is a bit the analog. You can, for the non-degenerate points. Now, what happens at the degenerate points? The degenerate points are kind of tricky because you have too many of them. So there have been a lot of works, for instance, by Carofalo, Petrosian, and many other people to try to study all the other points and to prove some stratification results. So they use many, Weiss monotonicity formula, non-monotonicity formula, many tools to classify them and try to prove some general stratification results. But it's not complete, in some sense. They cannot do everything. Something we did last year on this problem with Begonia Barrios and Chaviro Soton was the following fact, that if you add an assumption, as in Caffarelli, that the obstacle is superharmonic, so we are for fractional Laplacian, but the assumption of the obstacle is with the classical Laplacian, superharmonicity, then there are only two options. Either you grow as 1 plus s, or you grow as 2, but all the other powers never appear. So you only have two options, and then you can classify all the blobs. And in particular, you have a complete analog of Caffarelli result, where your free boundary splits in two parts, degenerate points and non-degenerate points. Non-degenerate points, the free boundary is C1 alpha. Degenerate points are contained in C1 hypersurfaces. So under this X assumption, the free boundary is completely understood. But OK, it's a strong assumption, because it must be, in some sense, there is a global assumption at infinity, in some sense. I mean, either you put in a REN, but the problem is the non-locality. So it's a stronger assumption than for the local case. But it's necessary. OK, so this is about the stationary case. And what is the main tool in all these proofs is that you have a monotonicity formula. So it will become technical for a second. This kind of quantity, the Algren frequency formula, is monotone non-decreasing for your free boundary problem. So if you take your solution and you look at this as a function of the radius, this is monotone. And what this function, this object captures is the homogeneity of your solution at zero. So if you take the limit as r goes to zero of this expression for an homogeneous function, the number you get is the homogeneity at zero. So this number tells you at which homogeneity your function is going. Is it 3/2? Is it 2? It is 7/2? Is it 4? Is 11/2? This guy is going to tell you. So having this monotonicity formula is crucial for classifying blowups. And then, so this is for the elliptic. Now, then you wanted to do the parabolic case. Actually, this has been something in my mind for quite a few years now. And the problem is that there is no Algren formula there. We tried like every type of, I don't know, we couldn't find it. So we don't have monotonicity formulas. So all the proofs that was available in the elliptic case completely breaks down. Then there is also a main problem that for S equal 1/2, there is no gap between 3/2 and 2. Because if you look at my traveling wave solutions, OK, I ruled out the negative exponent here, but I have all of them here. So this means that for every gamma between 1/2 and 1, I can find a solution that has homogeneity, that gamma. So it's not like here. You see, the theorem of Caffarelli, Salza, and Silvestre tells me if my homogeneity is below 2, then it must be 1 plus s. So there is a gap. There is nothing below 2 besides 1 plus s. I have no other homogeneity. For the elliptic, for the parabolic case, I can have every possible homogeneity between 3/2 and 2. So there is no quantization of homogeneities. And so that's another big difficulty, because, I mean, the fact that there was a continuum, there's a continuum homogeneity, really, even with a frequency formula, you would be in trouble, because there it's crucial that you have a gap. So there is this. But then, at least for the second remark, we looked around, and we noticed that for finance, if you look at models, usually S is around 0.7, which is greater than 1/2. So we said, OK, let's try, at least because we have a motivation, let's try to focus on S between 1/2 and 2 and 1. We rule out 1/2 for now. It could be mathematically extremely interesting, but at least for the motivation, S between 1/2 and 1 looks the most relevant. OK, and then what we proved is the following. So take a parabolic parabolic cylinder, and take a free boundary point. Then either your function goes exactly like 1 plus r to the 1 plus s, in this case, or is below r2 minus epsilon. So this is like in Caffarelli, Salza, Silvestre. If your homogeneity is below 2, so if you want, this tells you, so if this fails, this means that your homogeneity is above 2. Sorry, it's below 2. So if your homogeneity is below 2, then it's 1 plus s. So there is a quantization again. There is only one option. Below 2, there is 1 plus s. And in addition, if you are at these points, sorry, OK, I satisfy 1, but 1 is this. OK, I changed the notation. So before there was a 1 and a 2. OK, so if tx satisfies 1, where 1 is this, so if you are in these points where the homogeneity is 1 plus s, then the free boundary is 1 alpha, and you have a very sharp expansion for your solution around that point. So it behaves like, so this is like the one-dimensional solution, x minus x, well, for, p take x0 equals 0 and e equal 1. So this is x1 plus at positive part, 1 plus s. And for a equals 0 is the stationary solution. And it's interesting to observe that the regularity in x and time here, it's 1 plus s for both. So it's not anymore as in my result with Luis, where we proved the general result, but we had, you see, in the, our proof, the general result tells us that ut, I mean, between time and space, there is a difference. There is this 2s at the bottom. So you lose something here. No, there is nothing like that. Time and space be exactly equal. The regularity in time, the regularity in space is the same at that points. And in fact, you can see that by kind of the hyperbolic structure of blow-ups. I mean, it's time and space looks very similar in this expression. It's like a 1D profile in time and space that goes 1 plus s. OK, so in the last few minutes, 2-3 minutes, let me just try to explain you the strategy for what we did here. So the first thing we prove is that our solution is semi-convex. So that if you take two partial derivatives of u in any direction, where the direction is taken both in space and time, then the second derivatives are bounded from below by constant. And why this is important? Because if you take now a point for which two fails, so you assume that two fails, which is this. And then you want to prove that this must happen. So I assume that this is fail. I have a point where this fails. And what I do a blow up, where now I don't know how to blow up anymore. I mean, you remember Caffarelli was dividing by R square because he knew already the homogeneity. Here I don't know, so I divide by the soup. That's the only quantity I can divide to get something meaningful. So I take u, I subtract the obstacle, and OK, this should be u minus phi, sorry, inside, of course, u minus phi infinity. I blow up, and I get something, some function. Now, if you rescale in this way, you can prove that this semi-convexity assumption in the blow up becomes convexity. So every blow up is convex. But OK, this was not the main point. I mean, we already knew that this would happen. And also, because 2 fails, you can prove that your function at infinity grows less than r to the 2 minus epsilon. And now where the kind of first main difficulty comes is to say, OK, can I classify blow-ups? And this is what we did. We proved a Liouville theorem that proved that the only convex function that grows less than r to the 2 minus epsilon at infinity, and is convex, and solve my problem in the whole space, global solution, is stationary. So it's just the stationary solution of the Lichty problem constant in time. And here it's crucial that s is above 1/2, because the point is that space, because s is above 1/2, time and space scale differently. And so in the blow up, the time variable disappears. And that's why we can't have a stationary solution. This wouldn't be true for s equal 1/2. You will get still the time. Once we have the classification of blow-ups, we can, by some better argument, we can prove the optimal regularity in space and time, and we get the first Lipschitz regularity of the free boundary. This is soft, in that sense, this part. And then, by once you have Lipschitz, by some compactness, you can easily go to C1. But this is only space. So that's, again, by some barrier argument. But once you have C1, we could use some recent results by Rossoton and Serra about boundary Harnack in C1 domains to push to C1 alpha. So once you are C1, you're actually C1 alpha. This is like some elliptic regularity tool. But only space. We have no regularity in time yet. But then, in some sense, once I know that my free boundary is regular in space and is Lipschitz in space and time, and also I have my solution, and my solution is regular in space and time, you put the three information together, and you get regularity for the free boundary also in time. And that requires some work. And we get C1 bit and TX. And once you have all the regularity of the solution of the free boundary, everything together, you can prove the expansion near the free boundary. So this is the strategy of the proof. Then every step is kind of technical and they don't want to enter. But I will say that the main ingredient in this, well, there is the delicate parts here, but really, in some sense, the key point was to be able then to get this Liouville theorem. Once you, because this allowed us to have the blob, to show that the blob was what we wanted. Once we had the Liouville, then it became everything technical. But what we have been stuck for quite a while was that part. And so this gives everything, and that's all. So I thank you for your attention.
Grazie. Many thanks to Alessio for this beautiful and clear talk. Comments, questions?
There is no way.
It was a beautiful talk.
Oh, thank you.
I was confused at one point with the Signorini problem. You worked in all of Rn plus one.
Sure.
Before you worked in a half space. I was confused by that.
Yeah, the point is that I just do, if I do even reflection, that's completely equivalent in my situation. Because of the, that's true for the elliptic case. For the parabolic is not, I cannot do even reflection, but for the elliptic problem, the stationary problem, because UY is zero, I have the normal condition, I can just do even reflection, and then it becomes the problem in the wall of space. So these are completely equivalent. Uh-huh. For the parabolic, I can only half work in the half space. But
I thought the UI was zero because it was even in Y. So.
That's the two. So if you start from Signorini, UI is zero.
Yeah.
But if you start from the obstacle problem for the fractional ablation, then UI is zero because of the obstacle condition.
Uh-huh.
Then you need an extension.
I see.
I have a question which concerned the very beginning when you quoted my result with Kinderler C11, and you said it's optimal. Indeed, it is optimal, but when you say optimal, you always have to say in what class. It's optimal, no, and it's not a joke, it's optimal in the class of Hölder or Lipschitz, but in this paper, we also show an additional property, not in this class. We show that the Laplacian of U is BV. So here you get Laplacian of U is bounded. We prove Laplacian U is BV. So it's a much, so it's an interesting information, additional information, which, so it means roughly speaking that third order derivatives are measures. And I was wondering whether you have something similar for the fractional Laplacian, because you see that might be an interesting property in terms of fractional, because if you interpolate Laplace U is L infinity because of that. Laplace U is, roughly speaking, W11 is BV. So in between the two you interpolate, so the Laplace is H1/2, minus epsilon maybe. So in some sense you add might have add some fractional regularity, which might affect your fractional Laplacian. I don't know if you have anything similar for the fractional.
So that's a very good point. I have to admit I never checked that.
Sorry?
I never checked that, but I will definitely do, so
yeah.
To try to understand. So I didn't check how you proved the BV. So I will, because I mean a BV essentially is the finite perimeter
yeah.
The finite perimeter information on the free boundary.
Yeah, exactly. But we proved this without any information on the free boundary.
Right.
This is just from scratch.
Yeah,
and
I never thought about that. So thanks for the remark, because I don't think anyone try to prove anything in that direction. So
okay.
It's definitely a very good suggestion to try to look into that.
Okay.
Thanks. No, you're right. Yeah, in my case, I was always looking in older and Lipschitz classes.
More? No more?
So.
Could the obstacle depend on time?
Could the obstacle depend on time? So if the obstacle depends on time, I immediately lose the ut greater or equal than zero. Right? That's... Well, yes, I would say, right? Because if I start to move the obstacle, there is no reason why my function should keep being monotone in time, I think. If I start to lower it, then maybe my function has interest to adjust and go back. So that's... okay, so obstacle increase on time, solution will increase on time.
No, I just wonder if it's...
I think in terms of regularity,
yeah,
the part with Luis, I will say yes. Because once you have that, we use this UT non-negative to get... in fact, what I will need, I think, is U minus psi time derivative non-negative. That's really what I will need. Then I will, so if U minus the obstacle time derivative is non-negative, then I will say the regularity part is okay. And then the blow-up part is another issue because, well, although the one half, again, I mean, no, maybe this still this one with the, should work. For S greater than one half, it will work again, I think. But
well, I'm not so expert in this. So what about the classical case? I mean, in the classical case, not the fractional case, are obstacles allowed to depend on time or not? I just don't know. I mean, the problem becomes much more difficult.
Well, yeah, I don't see a main problem in the. Now I don't remember, I should check, but in the classical case I don't see a main difficulty because it's not really, I mean, I could always subtract the obstacle that becomes a right-hand side on the operator and then I have zero obstacle. Here is a new feature where really I need this extra monotonicity that I don't see. It's true, however, that if S is above one half, I'm in a good shape, but again, for all the proof, we still use UT non-negative. So this monotonic information is really crucial for our arguments. So for the classical case, I don't think it really plays a role. You don't have.
I think there are old works that deal with this in the classical formulation, right.
The fact that there is a time dependence, I don't see a difficulty there. But here there is for this monotonicity.
Alessio, for the time dependent, I think that do you have to assume in the way you are thinking that the obstacle is differentiable or not? Because this is the crucial threshold for the time dependent obstacles. Actually, you can do it. There are results also for degenerate operators. But then the crucial point is that the obstacle is differentiable in time or not. Because then this is the.
For me, the obstacle here is smooth.
Yeah, smooth, yeah.
As smooth as I need. I mean, I never checked how low you can go in regularity of the obstacle. But let's say I was already for my the first regularity result, the one with Ruiz, our obstacle has quite a few derivatives. And either for this proof, even more, we need. Already for the Scaffarelli, the stationary case, we need C21 on the obstacle to do the regularity of the free boundary. And for us, the regularity of the free boundary, we need basically...
Because we have also for degenerate operators, we have results that tells you that you can even assume that the obstacle is not differentiable in time.
Yeah, the main
but then you have to assume that you have to do a different blow up, but then this doesn't go through the rest of the proof. So only a few results can be done. So it will be interesting to see if this approach can be carried out also here.
Yeah, the main difficulty here for the elliptic case is that they use the Allengren frequency formula. And for that, they need C21 on the obstacle. In our proof, we don't use frequency formulas, but we need the semi-concavity condition, the step one, this. And this is true. This must be true for every xi, every direction of xi in space and time. And so essentially, you need on the initial datum that if you want that all second order derivatives are bounded at time zero. In particular, you need dTTU at time zero is bounded from below, which is like 4s derivatives on the initial datum. Otherwise, this is true provided the initial datum is smooth enough. So if you remove smoothness on the obstacle, I wouldn't know how to get this semi-convexity that is crucial to get that every blob is convex. So I think that removing regularity on the obstacle in this fractional problems is a kind of delicate issue.
No more. No, thanks, Alessio, again.
Thank you.